So up ahead, we're now approaching Fish Springs Cinder Cone, which is a fairly recent cinder cone. It's also part of the Big Pine volcanic field, just like that perlite dome we just visited. So this is a basaltic volcano, so it would have erupted basaltic lava. In this case, instead of flowing out in a steady flow, it would have spattered out in little chunks out of the center of that sort of conical depression. And then the chunks would have spattered out to form this tephra ring, or this sort of crater-like shape in front of us. You see this little asymmetric, probably the founding was founding a little bit to the west or something like that, because most of the highest side is on the west side. We're busy driving west, just for reference. And one of the interesting things about this particular cinder cone is that it brings up material directly from the mantle, including crystals of certain minerals chersetite and titanogite, which are these sort of rare titanium-rich crystals that you don't normally find in the Earth's crust, so it's a sign that these are visitors from someplace deeper. We're just going to park here. And we'll take a closer look. Okay, so now we walk around to the backside of the volcano. So here you can see is the main cinder cone this way. But if you look across this way, those black rocks are additional cinders that actually are part of the same exact volcano. Why they're black and not red? Well, it's hard to say, but usually the colors of rocks often just come down to a question of rust, basically. So the red ones basically have rusted, they turn red, the black ones remain their original black color. These red ones here would have also been black when they erupted, but the iron in them can easily be oxidized to iron 3+. Now why are these rusted and these aren't, I don't know. That's certainly a good question. But if these are part of the same thing, then the ones over there must have been lifted up. And actually, if you look closely, there's actually a whole long linear scarp here. So the land all of a sudden rises about, I don't know, 20, maybe not 20 meters, 15, 20 meters. And there's a big straight line that goes from, cuts across that alluvial fan there, cuts across here, cuts across the west side of the cinder cone here, and then it continues across the alluvial fan there. And so this is actually a fault scarp. Now, if you look closely, the way that offsets the cinder cone, it's lifted this side up clearly by, I don't know, like 15, 20 meters, but it's also moved that side to the right a little bit. So the edge of the cone here is wrapping around here. It would come in and it would meet about there, but now it's all the way over there. So it's been lifted up like 20 meters and to the right like 20 meters. So it's what we call an oblique strip, an oblique slip fault. So it's both a normal component, so it's dipping towards us. We're basically looking at the fault surface dipping towards us here. So the side we're on dropped down. As it dropped down, it slid down towards us, which is typical for a normal fault. But then at the same time, the block we're on moved to the left and it moved to the right at the same time. So it's moved both to the right, right lateral and normal sense displacement. Which is just an interesting thing to notice here. Now, it's probably no coincidence that there's a cinder cone that formed almost right along this fault. Probably the magma actually came up along the fault, and because that fault was provide a nice break through the Earth's crust where that magma could travel through. And then that fault would have been dipping up like this through the ground and probably someplace near the surface where that fault intersected the alluvium. It then broke off the fault and ended up erupting a little bit to the east of the fault. All right, sort of a neat story. As for why there's this fault here, the normal part is related to the uplift of the Sierras in there in the background. There's a whole series of normal faults to lift up those mountains. And the strike slip fault is related to actually slip from the San Andreas Fault. Something like a quarter of all the displacement across the San Andreas Fault, or across the plate boundary between the North American and the North American, the Pacific plates,
is a strike slip. And most of all, mostly we think of that strike slip as all being in the San Andreas Fault, but something like a quarter of it comes in various faults over here east of the Sierra Nevada. Now, this particular fault is only a small fraction of that, but that's where that strike slip comes from. Okay, so now we'll head up to the top of the hill here just to get a view.
Starting to get a better view of that fault start cutting across the plain there.
Okay, here we are at the top of the hill. So in front of us, these are the Inyo Mountains. They're bounded also by a normal fault along the front that drops down the valley and lifts up the mountains. You can see there's some more volcanoes down there that have erupted out of it. You can see that big, bad, broad black surface is the basalt flow. And then there's a red cinder cone to the right. So those are probably coming up that normal fault. Looking back up this way, so there's the Sierra Nevada again. That pancake in front of it is the perlite dome. So we stopped on the far side of that earlier. Looking this way, you can see another couple older cinder cones there. And then if you keep falling down down to this patch of green here, you can see there's a, well, you probably can't see because it's not zooming far enough. There's a little car going into a green clump back there at the saddle. That's Timaha Campground. That's where we would often camp for this class, which is a nice spot. Grass and trees and a little creek. Nice views of the Sierras, especially with the sunrise. It's really nice here. Tinamaha Reservoir down there. If you look off this way again, you can see the fault scarp coming across really nicely across here. It's the uplifting the basalt there. That whole hill is another big basalt flow, part of this Big Pine volcanic field. You can see the town of Big Pine back. Well, you can't quite see the town of Big Pine. You can see outlying trees from the town of Big Pine. And then that fault scarp is cutting across here, going to where those trees are at the Tinamaha Campground. I forget the name of this bowl. So if we look down into the bowl of the crater, it's been pretty eroded, so it's not anything exactly spectacular to write home about, but you know, it's a big bowl-shaped depression. It's slightly higher on the north side. Again, if it was erupting up the fault and the fault is dipping this way, you might expect the lava to come fountaining out preferentially to the west. Okay, time to head back to the vehicle.